Well, good evening. We're glad that you're with us here at Grassy Valley Baptist Church on this wonderful Wednesday night. I know it's bitter and cold outside, but we're glad that you joined us. We're going to be talking about building for unity. As you see the PowerPoint presentation there, the slide that's up in front of you there, building for unity, the community rebuilds the wall. And I'm excited about talking about this tonight. I've already been chastised for making some of these lessons a little shorter than what they're used to. Most people are used to spending about 45 minutes to an hour with me teaching. But I'll tell you right up front, tonight is the last night that we'll be doing it like this, hopefully for a long time. Hopefully we'll be able to meet back together. We're going to start back in February, and we're going to be meeting on Wednesday nights here at the church. We are still taking several precautions. We don't want to get too out of whack with things and start spreading COVID again. We want to be on guard about it, but we feel like it's necessary for us to meet as often as we can. And so we're going to start meeting back Wednesday night, the first Wednesday night in February, and we'd love for you to join us. We're going to ask that you don't bring any food. We're not going to have any food for a group fellowship, and we're not going to have any desserts for the month of February. We think that serving food can possibly hinder us and can cause more of the spread, and we don't want to do that. We're still asking you to wear masks. We're still going to be using the ionizer to disinfect the fellowship hall. And so we're trying to make it as safe as possible. You're feel free to bring your own food if you want to sit and eat McDonald's or something like that, or you maybe brought something from home. That's fine. But we're not going to have a community where we share the food and have a dinner on the grounds type thing. We're just going to have a Bible study, and we'll be able to ask questions again and all that good stuff. So I'm excited about meeting back the first Wednesday night in February. We're also going to be starting back with Sunday school the first Sunday in February, and it's going to be a joint session, which I'm excited about. Brother Richard's going to teach this joint session in the fellowship hall. We're trying to keep everybody spread out in the big room, and we can all sit around tables and so forth, and he'll teach the first lesson. And then the second Sunday, we've asked Debbie Halterman to teach, and she's a wonderful teacher. We'll enjoy her. The third Sunday, Brother Alan Kirk is going to teach, and I'm excited about him teaching one of the classes. And then Brother Leroy Brown will be teaching the fourth class, the fourth Sunday. And that gives us a chance to see everybody in action as far as Sunday school is concerned. And so we'll just do that for the month of February. We'll have Sunday school, we'll have church, and we'll have Wednesday night services. We're just going to minus the food for right now. And I think you'll understand for that moment, but for this time. Well, I'm excited about tonight's lessons. It is a little, I'm going to be honest with you up front. The biggest portion of this is a little mundane, a little boring. You say, well, why are you excited about it? I'm excited about it because it shows the work. It shows how everybody gets involved. It shows how everybody plays a part in rebuilding the wall of Jerusalem. And Nehemiah is a great leader. I don't know if you've ever experienced this or not. I know you've probably seen it on TV. You've probably seen it in movies. The Amish are very famous for doing barn raising, is what they call it. They're famous for doing it because what will happen, they all get together on a certain day that they've chosen. All the wood, all the lumber is delivered. And early in the morning, all the men, all the children, all the women, they all gather at this the particular place, and the men will start the hard work of shaving the wood and cutting the wood and getting it formed, and they'll build the walls and they'll start raising the walls. In the meantime, the children are used for gophers. They go get the wood, they go get the hammers, they get the tools, they get the nails or whatever they use. They get whatever they have to have, and then the women are involved by making breakfast and making lunch and making dinner, and it's an all day affair. And everybody plays a part. And so they work together, they eat together, they fellowship together, and they continue working. And most of the time, they'll get to where they can finish a whole barn in one day, which is really amazing. So if you've ever seen anything like that, or you've ever even seen it in the movies, it's quite astonishing. I was reading a commentary. It says just a number as we look at this passage in chapter 3 of Nehemiah, and we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 32. The commentator says this: just the numbers of Israelites alone who are mentioned, who gave their hearts and souls to repairing various parts of the wall and her gates, are simply astonishing. Nehemiah had widespread support by various groups and their leaders. For example, the men of Jericho, found in chapter 3, verse 2. The Tekoites, in chapter 3, verse 5. The men of Gibeon and Mizpah, in chapter 2, verse 7, and so forth. So, one commentator by the name of Tolson notes that Nehemiah skillfully divided the workforce into some 40 manageable work crews. Now, that's a lot. That's a lot of work crews. That took a lot of planning, I'm sure. If you read through this chapter, you start to see how many people were involved and how many different work crews were going on. So let's look at this chapter briefly, and we're going to look at Nehemiah chapter 3, verse 1. So if you've got your Bible, turn to Nehemiah chapter 3, verse 1. It says there, then Eliashib, the high priest, arose with his brothers, the priest, and built the sheep gate. They consecrated it and hung its doors. They consecrated the wall to the tower of the hundred and the tower of Hanel. Now, what is this talking about? Now, here's what I'll just share right up front. This is a little mundane. I'm going to show you some PowerPoint. We're going to look at a map of the city of Jerusalem, an old city map, and where the gates were. So I'm going to keep going back and forth here. So just follow along with me. It kind of gives you an idea of where these gates were and what the city looked like and so forth. And then when we get to the end, I'll talk a little bit about how it applies to us. But anyway, let's just kind of go through the bear with me. Don't fall asleep. Just watch and kind of follow along. This is interesting stuff if you're really into that. But some people may not find it too interesting. I hope you do. But anyway, we're going to look at some of the gates. So let me just click this over and let you see this map. Eliashib is the high priest. And if you've got your notes, and by the way, you can download those notes by going to Grassy Valley grassyvalley.org, and you can go through the resources tab and you can download the notes for this class. And if you're following along, we're on session or lesson 4. And if you've got your notes, there's some fill in the blanks there. Those highlighted words are where you fill in the blanks. So Eliashib, the high priest, he was the grandson of Jeshua, and you find that in Nehemiah chapter 12, verse 10, the leader in the time of the construction of the temple. Now the priest, even the high priest, did not just direct others, but they themselves would roll up their sleeves and get to work. Now, I'm going to tell you something about that, because I believe that good leadership is not dictatorship. I believe good leadership is a servanthood type of leadership. Someone that says, hey, let's go set up the tables in the fellowship hall. And rather than just directing, the leader will roll up his sleeves and get busy carrying the chairs and carrying the tables and setting up, helping those around them set up. And so he had a priest that didn't just delegate. Those priests actually rolled up their sleeves, got busy building the wall and building the gates. And so they went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. Now you say, well, what is the sheep gate? Well, let's go back and look at this. You see the red arrow there up on top of the map. That red arrow is pointing to the sheep gate. In this verse, Nehemiah gives the account of what part of the wall was built first. The sheep gate was the northernmost part of the city. It was important to start there because this is where the very place of where most attacks upon Jerusalem took place. According to some commentaries, this part of the wall would have been most heavily damaged. So it was important that they would repair that to keep them from being attacked. The towers were important because of their importance to defending the city. The watchers would have been able to see the enemy coming from a great distance and would be able to sound the alarm so that they could let the people know, get the men out so that they could defend the city. And John Gill, he is another commentator, he writes in his commentary this. He says, the sheep gate was so called because the sheep were led through this gate into the temple, and near it was the sheep market, where they were sold, and the sheep pool, which is another area, where the sacrifices were washed. And this being near the temple, and for the service of it, the priest undertook that responsibility. Now, near the gate, you see still, he says, the sheep pond, which is large and deep, wherein the Nephilims used to watch the beast. We used to wash the beast and then gave them to the priest. And it's said to lead to the Mount of Olives, to Bethany, to Jericho, the desert, and all the east country to Jordan. When my wife and I went to Israel, we were up on the Mount of Olives, and we could look down and we could see the sheep gate. There's a lot of interesting stories about that I could go into. But that was really neat how the road actually from Jericho came right across the northern part of the city. So yes, the Mount of Olives to Bethany to Jericho, all very important part of the city was that northern gate, the sheep's gate. And then we see the fish gate, okay? The fish gate. This was near, you'll see the arrow there, I've changed the slide. The fish gate in chapter 3, verse 3, was near the northwest corner, probably also called the Ephraim gate, and also the middle gate. Okay? Now, it's thought to be near the location of the present date, the gate of called Damascus Gate today. It was called the fish gate because the merchants sold fish on the northern side of Jerusalem. You see, the men of Tyre and other coastal towns would bring their fish from those areas over to Jerusalem and sell their fish there at the gate. And I'm sure it took probably, you know, half a day's journey to get from the boats there on the coastal to come on over with their horses and buggies and so forth. It may have taken a little longer, but they would sell their fish there at those gates. Then you have the Tekoa gate, located southeast of Bethlehem and was the home of the prophet Amos. Since it was close to the area controlled by Geshem and the Arab, perhaps the nobles who would not put their shoulders to the work were influenced or afraid of him. Another commentary, John MacArthur states, one explanation beyond just the laziness of the rich is that these nobles had been pledged to Tobiah for personal gain. You're going to find out about Tobiah. Tobiah is a wicked man. He tries to destroy the work that's going on. And so these wealthy people may have been influenced by him and may have stopped the work. Then there is the, let's go to the next slide, the Jeshaniah Gate. It's often referred to or known as the Gate of the Old City. The Gate of the Old City or Mishnah Gate. It was near the northwest corner of the city. Then there's the broad wall, as you see right there. It's kind of a darker blue, but the arrow is also pointing to it in chapter 3, verse 8. And the Tower of Ovens on the western side of Jerusalem. And then if we go on, we look at the Pool of Siloah in chapter 3, verse 15. It's in the southeast sector. As you see down here, you see the arrow pointing, and then you have the red outline. You have the armory located on the eastern side of Jerusalem. And then you have the surrounding region. And that's what those big red arrows are for there. It's kind of referring to the rural area around Jerusalem. The court of the guard is mentioned in verse 25, and also in Jeremiah 32, verse 2, the hill of the hill of Ophel was part of the east ridge between the city of David and the temple area. And then the water gate led from the palace temple complex to the Gihon Spring. And then we go to the next slide, and you'll see the horse gate. to the northeast sector. You have the East Gate, possibly located to the east of the Temple Mount, and you'll see the temple, that little square right in the very top there. That's the Temple Mount, would right there. And there would have been chambers there. Okay, the house of the temple. Let me go to the next slide. The house of the temple. There were chambers or rooms in the temple construction, and Ezra indicates this in Ezra chapter 10, verse 6, and also Nehemiah chapter 12, verse 44. You hear about it because Tobiah's family, and he's related by marriage to Meshulam, who even gave Tobiah the use of one of these rooms, and we find that out later on in our studies. We find out about the inspection gate, sometimes translated the mustard gate or watch gate. One commentator by the name of Blensop suggests it may have been designated point for assembly and review, perhaps for the temple or palace guards. And then, of course, we go on and we see the Mifkad gate. It's in the northeastern sector, and then the Sheep Gate. We come all the way back around to where we started, and we've traveled counterclockwise all the way around to where we began. Okay? Now, I know that this chapter is somewhat mundane. You say, "Well, Mark, why is it so important that that we see this?" It's important because you want to get an idea as you're reading the word. I mean, sometimes I get confused when I'm reading the word of God and I see all these names. It doesn't make much sense to me. But when you look at maps and you see how different gates were put in certain places, and if you ever get an opportunity to go to Israel, which I hope you do one day, you get to kind of get a lay of the terrain and see what is around the city and how it's sat, and you can begin to see how armies would come from different directions to attack. So it's important that they rebuilt these walls and they put up these gates simply for the very place that for the fact that it was secure. Let me go to the next slide and show you. There's some important aspects. You know, the wall served as a secure place, militarily speaking. I mean, you have to think about those kinds of things because people had to be defended. One of the reasons why Nehemiah was so concerned about the people of Israel, and their, you know, he mourned over it, was because they were still in reproach. They were still being able to be attacked from every side. There was no protection for them. And you know, we've lived in a country here in America that we have felt very secure for a long time. We have a great military. We've had in the past some great leaders, and they have done a really good job protecting our country. I don't know that that's going to happen forever. We can see some things happening now that may indicate that we may lose our protection pretty soon. But for now, we're still very much protected. And walls served as a line of protection from those that would come in and try to destroy them. So speaking militarily, it was a secure place. And then you think about the reference to people involved showed the separation from pagan influence by giving them an identity and a distinctiveness. You know, it made them who they were. I mean, if you were to go to another country right now, there's a distinction there. We don't necessarily do it by walls anymore, but there's a distinction when you fly from America to, say, Guatemala, or you fly from America down to Brazil. There's a different distinction that we see in people, and in walls and cities gave them an identity. They were the Jewish people. They lived in Jerusalem. And just like America has the capital city, and we have America, we have walls along the southern border. We are distinct from Canada. We're distinct from Mexico. We are a nation. And this basically was their city, and they had to give them a distinction, an identity. And then, of course, you've got It represented a reversal of the humiliation of defeat and destruction suffered because of Israel's sin. I mean, think about this for just a moment. Now they're starting to rebuild. It means that maybe things are changing. Things are happening. There's an excitement that's taking place. They're beginning to build the wall. They've got their identity. They're getting their security. Maybe God is going to come back and bless them, and they're going to start doing some great things again. They're going to have a peaceful nation again. Maybe they're going to be prosperous again. And so it's a reversal. It's hey, we're no longer being punished. We've done our due. We've paid our due for our idolatry. Now it's time to return to God, and God is going to bless our nation. And that's a reversal. I think even the last one was the rebuilt walls would assure the Jews of God's redemptive presence among them. Again, we're going back to the very fact that God has punished them, yes, for their sin. And now he is redeeming his people. He's bringing them back. He's going to secure them. He's going to give them peace. He's going to prosper them. And we see that this is all part of God's plan. What a great plan it is to redeem his people from what they had done. Now, you say, well, Brother Mark, how does this apply to me? What can I take away from all of this? Well, there's some things that I think that are important that we can learn from this passage, as mundane and as technical as it may have sounded, as boring as it might have sounded. There's some things that we can learn as Christians from this, and I want you to see this. Number one, everyone should be involved in serving God. Don't you agree? Everyone should be involved in serving God. There's a lot of people out there that are Christians that they feel that they're serving God just by showing up on Sunday morning. And believe me, I appreciate faithfulness. I do. We talk about faithfulness all the time, that you would never consider your car to be faithful if it only started up once a month. And so we don't consider you to be faithful in a church if you only come once a month. You're faithful if you come every week. Every time the doors are open, that's faithfulness. But we understand that some people out there, I know, people feel like they're doing their duty, they're doing their service for God if they show up once a month, or even if they show up on Christmas or Easter. We call them C&E Christians, you know. They feel like that they've done their duty and they're serving God. But listen, as we've talked in our Discover class, if you haven't taken that yet, I encourage you to take it. Discover Grassy Valley. Again, you can go to our website, grassyvalley.org. Click on the resources tab and you can look at the Discover class. You can download the notes, read them for yourself. And we talk about spiritual gifts and how God gives each believer a spiritual gift that he or she is to use for the glory of God. God has gifted you with something, some kind of gift that you are to serve him with. And maybe it's musical talent. Maybe it's a musical ability that God's gifted you with, and you need to be using that musical gift for the service of God. Maybe it's the gift of helps. You say, well, Brother Mark, I don't know where I can be helpful. Well, there's all kinds of places you can be helpful in the church. We have a food pantry ministry here that you can volunteer your time. We have things around the church that need to be fixed and updated. You can volunteer your time and do those things. You know, there's all kinds of things that you can do. Well, you have to get the administration. We need people with that. We need people with all kinds of gifts. Gifts of giving, gifts of service, gifts of helps, gift of shepherding, gift of teaching, you know, working with children. You have gifts that God has blessed you with that you ought to be serving. And if everybody plays their part, if everybody were to serve, can you imagine what could happen? We usually use the 80-20% is what we call it in seminary. And I've said this before, that 20% of the people do 80% of the work. They also contribute that to giving as well, that 20% of the people give 80% of the money and that is given in the church. So We don't want to be that kind of church. What we want to be, as we've talked about in our vision, is that we want to be authentic believers that are passionate about Jesus Christ. And when you're authentic and you're a real person, you've made real mistakes, but you're authentic in your passion for Jesus, it pours out of you. You can't help but serve the Lord. You can't help but love the Lord. You can't help but worship the Lord. You can't help but love others, because that passion for Jesus just oozes out of us. And so that's what the kind of person I want our church to be. We want to be passionate about Jesus, using those gifts that God has given us to use for His glory. And just imagine for a moment if everybody in the church did one thing, just did one ministry. I'm not talking about, you know, come to church. I'm talking about being faithful to church on Sunday. I'm talking about actually serving in one area of the church. That would take the burden off a lot of people, because some people are serving in two and three and four areas, and they're getting overburdened. We need help in our multimedia program. We need help in music. We need help in children. We need help all over the place. And if you would just use one gift, if you would just serve in one ministry, if everybody would do that, then everybody is working on the wall. Everybody is working on their gate. Everybody is working on their section. You're not responsible for the whole wall. You're just responsible for your section. Can you imagine what God would do through a church where everybody rolled up their sleeves and just did one ministry and did it to the best of their ability? Now, that's what I think should happen. Everyone should be involved in serving God. But number two, think about this one. Even our enemies would be amazed at what we can accomplish when we are in unity and exhibit a cooperative spirit. How many times have you heard the world, when I say the world, have the secular field? How many times have you heard about them say, well, that church down there, they're nothing but hypocrites. They're hypocrites, and they're nothing but two-faced liars. You know, and they talk about churches as having splits. And, oh, did you hear about that church down there? The pastor did this, and that person did this. Oh, man, the kind of reputation that the world sees in the church, the kind of reputation the church has in the world, I'm going to tell you, it makes a big difference. When we work together and unity is done in a church, and the world looks and sees a church working together and accomplishing things, man, what a testimony that is for the Lord. Not for just the church, but for the Lord. What kind of damage do we do to ourselves and to God's reputation when we are disunified, when we are at each other's throats, when we're not working together, when everybody's trying to do their own thing and it's not getting anywhere? We get frustrated. We all want to leave. There's splits take place, and it damages the reputation of the church, and most importantly, it damages God's reputation, because people don't think, well, is God even real? I mean, these people fight all the time. Worst place in the world to be is in the church, it seems like. So it would really help. Our enemies would be amazed. Our enemies, the world, those people we need to love, the world would be amazed. They would be astounded when we accomplish what we're wanting to do in unity and working in a cooperative spirit. I'm going to tell you something. I'm amazed at what God is doing right now in our church through our food pantry. Just today, just this week, we've had people come by the church and drop off bag after bag after bag of food. We've had several tables filled with food donations because people are looking at our church and going, wow, they're doing something for the community. And God is blessing. And we're having people volunteer and come down here and work. And this is cool thing. They're working together in joy. They're working together in joy, Christian love, and every time, this is really neat, every time they bring in a group of a bunch of food and that person leaves, guess what? All the volunteers gather around all that food and we give thanks to God in prayer, thanking the Lord for what he's provided, praying to God, saying, Lord, may we use this food for your glory. May this food bless somebody. And may you be praised in the midst. Man, I'm going to tell you, we're praying over the food. We're praying over the people that are bringing. I'm telling you, this is a wonderful ministry, and we're working in unity together, and you can be a part of it. You can be a part of it, not just in giving, but coming down and spending time. You will be blessed by working together cooperatively as a church. And the world will see that, and what a testimony that will bring. One more thing. Godly leaders know how to choose leaders and delegate authority. I noticed that about Nehemiah. Godly leaders know how to choose leaders and delegate authority. Listen, sometimes, I'll be honest with you, as a pastor, I've been in church work long enough that we just take anybody that volunteers. I mean, if you've got a warm body and you've got a pulse and you can do something, and you say, yeah, I'll be glad to help you any way I can, we say, there you go, let's put them to work. The problem with that is that sometimes people are put in positions where they're not gifted, they're not qualified for, they're not able to serve God that way because that's not where their heart is. We've been guilty, most churches are guilty of putting people on committees or ministry teams, or teaching in a Sunday school class, or working with children. And those people have no business doing that because they're not gifted in that area. They have no desire to work in that area, but they said, I'll do it because nobody else is doing it. And we shouldn't be that way. Good leaders will say, hold on. Let's stop for a moment and let's do what we do to the best of our ability. And if we don't have someone to fill that spot, we're not going to do it. If we don't have somebody gifted, not someone just to fill the spot, but if we don't have somebody gifted to fill that spot, then we don't need to do it. Until God brings someone our way, or until we lead someone to the Lord, or we come along and we grab somebody and say, hey, are you gifted in this area? Then when God brings that person our way, then we're able to fill that position when God has given someone there that has that gift to do that position. That's when it becomes effective. And good godly leaders will recognize that. And it doesn't just fall on the pastor's shoulders. It does. I mean, I understand the buck stops with me. But also it falls on good staff, and it falls on good deacons and leadership in the church, even those that are in the nominate committee. It falls on their shoulders too. They need to recognize, okay, are we putting this person in this committee or on this ministry team that has that gift? Or are we just trying to fill a position because we have to have someone to fill that position? We have to be very careful about that because it won't be done. It won't be done effectively. And good, godly leaders will do that. They'll pray about it. And there is nothing wrong. There is nothing wrong with cutting something out if you don't have someone to lead it. Okay? Not all of us can be as big as First Baptist Concord or Sevier Heights. Sometimes a small church just has to be a small church, and we can't offer 1,500 ministries. Sometimes we just have to do what we do and do it well, find out where God's working, and join Him. That's the kind of mentality I want our church to have. I really want us to be involved. Everyone is involved in serving God. I want us to work together in unity, and I want us as leaders to help people. And by the way, as a good godly leader, sometimes you see the gift in someone and that it's not cultivated yet. So as a good godly leader, it would be my job to go alongside that person and help them. As the Bible says, my job is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. So it's my job as a leader to help bring them along, to encourage them, to teach them, to help them in their ministry so that they can do it effectively. Well, I know this has been a shorter study. I know sometimes you get upset with that, but don't be upset. I think it's a good study, and I hope that you haven't been too bored. I'm excited about starting back up next Wednesday. We'll be meeting in the service and be meeting in our fellowship hall at 6:30. So I hope to see you on next Wednesday in person, but more importantly, I hope to see you Sunday. Sunday at 10:45, we have worship. I'm excited about it. The very first Sunday, this is our last Sunday just having church, no Sunday school. Then February the 7th, we'll be having our very first day back, full swing, Sunday school, church, and Wednesday night. And I hope that if you don't have a home church and someone has shared this video with you, I hope that you will pray about, consider coming to Grassy Valley, being a part of this church. We're a church that's doing something for God. We're passionate about Jesus Christ. We're passionate about others, and we're authentic. We're going to be people that we will make mistakes. We'll own up to our mistakes. We'll repent of our sin, and we'll love one another in spite of our failures. We're just authentic. We're just real. So hope that you'll be a part of our family. We'd love to have you. So God bless you, and I'll see you next Sunday.